people have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course we rely on media.
And I think the government has not.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Shreya Savitre with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show. India and Nepal have had a formidable bilateral relationship since time immemorial, and an improved connectivity for the purpose of trade, strategic depth and people-to-people connection has been considered a key component to the ever-prospering ties. India has not just maintained that Nepal is its perennial friend, but has committed selflessly to Himalayan nation's construction, reconstruction post-earthquake and development at larger scale. A railway section was recently opened under the same line of efforts to support Nepal. Have a look.
Equipped with latest technology, Janakpur-Jayanagar railway link that has been constructed with Indian assistance is ready to be operational. The two sides hosted a formal gathering on the occasion and underlined the efforts being made on both sides to speedily enhance the multi-level ties between them. Under the grant assistance of the Government of India, the gauge conversion of around 35-kilometre narrow-gauge section into broad-gauge from Jayanagar in India to Kurtha in Nepal was constructed. 35-kilometre Jayanagar-Kurtha section is part of a nearly 70-kilometre Jayanagar-Bijalpura-Bardibas rail link being developed under Indian grant assistance of 8.77 billion Nepalese rupees.
आज जयनगर बिजलपुरा प्रतिवास को जयनगर कुर्ता खंड को रेलवे संगठना को हस्तांतरण ले नेपाल में ब्रॉड गेज लाइन डर डेमू ट्रेन से सहित आधुनिक रेल सेवा संचालन को ढोका खुले को मैं महसूस करती हूँ.
While the two sides had earlier pledged to jointly develop small sections, they now have committed to take it to next and broader level this year. Now a gigantic project comprises building a broad gauge rail line between Kathmandu and Raxaul that will link Nepal's capital Kathmandu with the Indian railway network, providing access to all Indian cities. The railway system will pass through the historical town of Janakpur, which is of great religious significance to both sides. Experts believe the $3.15 billion project will also prove cornerstone to robust bilateral and strategic ties between the two sides.
Connectivity between the people of our two countries is one of the central features of Prime Minister Modi's neighborhood first policy in our region. Why? Because connectivity lies at the very heart of everything that we as a society do, that we as a country do, and then we as a people do. Whether it's economic activity, cultural exchanges, or even just very simple exchanges between the people of the two countries.
Calling Nepal a perennial partner of New Delhi, India has consistently backed and supported its development endeavours. From small-scale development projects to providing assistance in its reconstruction and gasoline lines, India has ensured the pace of development in Nepal grows exponentially. Before being hit by the second wave of the COVID pandemic, which had severely affected India, New Delhi had generously supported Nepal in its vaccination process too. And now, when it has resumed its global export of vaccine, Nepal is going to be one of the prime beneficiaries. The visits and reciprocal visits of top leadership in two countries are also suggestive of rapidly deepening ties between the two. With an open border, while the citizens of the two countries do not differentiate and discriminate between two sides, the joint leadership has ensured the bond is strengthened with every rising sun.
Moving on, The Afghan humanitarian situation is depleting by the day, and the Taliban-ruled country is now staring at a massive crisis. Poverty and unemployment are widespread, and in absence of money owing to Washington freezing Afghan accounts, the international observers fear that a large section of the society, nearly 60% of them, stand on the cusp of having acute food shortage. A global appeal has been made by the United Nations, urging countries to support, but little response has so far been witnessed, with countries still doubting the Taliban's credibility.
The economic crisis in Afghanistan is rapidly worsening, and most of the country's population has plunged below the poverty line since the Taliban swept to power this August. Humanitarian organizations say millions of Afghans, including children, could die of starvation unless an urgent intervention is made. According to World Food Programme's projections, 22.8 million people, more than half of Afghanistan's 39 million population, were facing acute food insecurity compared to 40 million just 2 months ago. And under the current scenario, when the unemployment rate is growing exponentially, the situation is on the brink of collapse. People are making distressed appeals for help, but little have they been assisted so far.
واقعاً کلی می‌بینیم که ما در یک بحران اقتصادی خراب قرار داریم. وضعیت مردم این تقریباً 99% مردم زیر خط فقر زندگی دارن. مشکلات بی نهایت زیاد است. شما می‌بینید چند قبل که 8 تا کودک از گشنگی جان داد.
And while Taliban-ruled Afghanistan is in dire need of assistance, Washington, which has frozen billions of dollars of Afghan money, has found itself in a tough spot. The Taliban, which had promised to present a modern and liberal version of it if returned to power, has sadly followed the same model of governance it employed in the 90s. And the progress made by non-military US aid of over $150 billion and billions of others from the different countries and organizations in the past 2 decades is reversing by the day. The current Taliban cabinet, which makes claims of being inclusive and is demanding to be recognized globally, hasn't included any women or people belonging to ethnic, religious, or linguistic minorities. In fact, they have been targeting these people and not letting girls go to school. Apart from this, a potential threat of radicalization and a possible Taliban support to Islamic terrorism in future are major factors behind Washington freezing the Afghan money. Observers around the world fear Afghanistan might plunge into a humanitarian crisis if it wasn't provided with substantial financial assistance, but they also blame the Taliban for creating such a situation. And amidst all this, it is the common Afghan who is suffering.
با این وضعیت اگر جامعه جهانی کشورهای قدرتمند کشورهای دارای اقتصاد بالا اگر افغانستان را کمک نکنه کشورهایی که داد از حقوق بشر میزنه داد از عدالت میزنه داد از مساوات برابری میزنه اگر در این شرایط افغانستان را تنها بگذاره کمک نکنه به داد مردمی مظلوم افغانستان نرسه وضعیت در آینده بحرانی است.
Major international players, including the United Nations and the regional influencers like Russia, have urged the US to come to the rescue, but the White House is yet to take a call. UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres has called for the International Monetary Fund to agree on waivers or mechanisms to get money into Afghanistan. The IMF has also blocked the Taliban from accessing some $440 million in new emergency reserves. But even if the money is given to Afghanistan, it is not going to bring any significant change in the country's situation. It is the entire economy that is at stake. It is the entire state that stands on the verge of failure. Only an integrated global effort can save the country, and that is not appearing to be happening anytime in near future.
Moving on, while Pakistan leadership can be blamed for country's free-falling economic situation, no one can take away the credit from Islamabad for establishing sophisticated global terrorist headquarters and creating an ecosystem that has mastered the art of furthering propaganda. Right from its Prime Minister Imran Khan to the army of social media trolls it has employed are working overtime to spin an anti-India narrative on Kashmir. Today we'll show you how not only what it says is false, but also what the ground reality of Pakistan-occupied Kashmir and Gilgit-Baltistan is, a fact that its paid media has self-censored and its leaders have built their rhetoric around.
These pictures are from Pakistan's Sheikhupura region in Punjab province, where a banned Islamist group clashed with the police. Not to forget, this province is the powerhouse of the country, from where most of the country's political influence is generated and army generals picked. A hardline Islamist group that was propped and strengthened by the very same leaders of the current dispensation has come to haunt them. Result: more radicalization, more violence, and more deaths. And this is not an isolated incident of protests, but the report card of the Imran Khan government. And if this is the situation in Punjab, just think what the scenario would be like in the regions it has illegally occupied, the regions of POK and Gilgit-Baltistan. Exponentially proliferating terror camps, consistently diminishing human rights, and a state-manufactured situation where people are more or less living a second-class life. And while international media has been successfully managed by Islamabad's propaganda machinery, the local wing doesn't even dare to think of showcasing their plight. From water to infrastructure to healthcare and inflation, a Kashmiri under illegal occupation of Pakistan has been reeling under all sorts of issues that fall under government jurisdiction.
Humne ameeron ko gareeb kar diya, gareebon ko gareeb tar kar diya. Log roti ke liye haath phailane pe majboor hai. Hospitalon ke bahar logon ki line lagi hai. Aapne dawaiyan mehangi karke blood pressure, sugar, heart ke mareez, buzurgon ko बिस्तर मरक पे सिसक सिसक के मरने पे मजबूर किया है और तुम मदीने की रियासत के नाम लेते हो. लानत होनी चाहिए तुम्हारी शक्लों और तुम्हारी अकलों पे.
And not just their plights have not been brought to the international attention, their struggle for freedom too has faced all forms of hindrances. A recently organized anti-Pakistan protest outside the Pakistan High Commission in London to mark October 22nd as Black Day, the day on which in 1947 Pakistan occupied the region with brute force, didn't gather the attention it deserved. Activists highlighted through their speeches the human rights violations being carried out on a massive scale. Underscoring their right to self-determination, the activists said that they would not settle for anything less than complete independence.
Aaj yahan Pakistan High Commission ke bahar khade hokar Pakistani awamon tak hum apna ye paigham pahunchana chahte hain ki riyasat Jammu Kashmir ke log azadi chahte hain. Aapne riyasat Jammu Kashmir ke wasail loote, aapne wahan ke janglaat kaate, aapne wahan ke ziraat ko tabah kiya, wahan ki local industry ko tabah kiya. आपने वहाँ के पानियों का रुख मोड़ा और चाइना के साथ मिलकर आपने वहाँ पे गैर कानूनी तौर पर उनसे सरमायाकारी करवाई और उस हम आपसे ये मुतालबा करते हैं कि आप चाइना से की गई गैर कानूनी सरमायाकारी के जो खुफिया मायदे हैं वो सरे आम पर लाएं, मंजर आम पर लाएं, ताकि हमारे लोग उससे वाकिफ हो सकें कि आपने किस तरह एक वकील बनकर रियासत जम्मू कश्मीर के बाशिंदों की पीठ पे छुरा घूंपा। आप हमारे आजादी के असल दुश्मन हैं।
And while this is the story of POK and its people, the other version of Pakistan is not just a complete lie, as the state of Jammu and Kashmir is not only witnessing a holistic development, but it is being subjected to Pak-sponsored terrorism too. A terrorist captured alive by security forces last month exposed the heinous and satanic agenda Pakistan is hell-bent on. Bleed India by thousand cuts. There are hundreds of other instances when Pakistan has been exposed. Islamabad keeps denying and the international community keeps dragging its feet. And for the same, it's been nearly 3.5 years since Pakistan has been on the grey list of the Financial Action Task Force, a global terror financing watchdog. Kashmiris have time and again urged the global community to take cognizance of the human rights violations and address the expanding terror activities in the region. But the community is yet to make any tangible effort to come to the rescue of the suppressed Kashmiris.
And now in our section of Asia This Week, the stories from across the continent that hit the headline this week.
Israel will build some 3,000 homes for Jewish settlers in the occupied West Bank, a step that has drawn strong criticism from its US ally. An Israeli defense official said a planning forum of Israel's liaison office with the Palestinians gave preliminary approval for plans to build 1,344 housing units and its final go-ahead for projects to construct 1,800 homes. The United States had already voiced strong opposition to the plans to advance the settlement units in the West Bank, saying such moves would damage prospects of a two-state solution to the Israel-Palestine conflict. Rinnai, a Japanese manufacturer of thermal energy equipment, has a long history of its support to improving the daily lives of Japanese people. The company is expanding globally and is coming up with high-quality products. While achieving the targets of Sustainable Development Goals and a huge internet society, Rinnai has announced guidelines for DX digital transformation. One of the best efforts for digital transformation is the application Rinnai Biz that connects with customers. Although there is a lack of physical interaction in the internet world and the digital space, the advantages of digital technology are great.
Rinnai が世の中に公開しているカタログに関しては、すべてですね、デジタルカタログとして Rinnai Biz 上に公開をしております。例えば新商品が、お風呂が泡が出て楽しめるというものがあるんですけれども、どれぐらいの泡が出ますっていうのは、やっぱり口で伝えるよりもこう分かりやすい。というのは、ありまして、こういったものっていうのもお客様がご自分で好きな時に好きに選んで使っていただけるというふうに公開をしております。
Rinnai Biz helps customer lead a convenient life. DX's Rinnai initiative offers quality service and enables citizens to enjoy high quality products.Onagawa is a small town located in Miyagi Prefecture of northeastern Japan. During the 2011 tsunami, the town lost 800 people along with most of coastal area being distorted. But now Onagawa has evolved as the symbol of recovery. It is rebuilt with many beautiful buildings like the main station, which is located at the center of the town. However, it is the new school that is the main symbol of reconstruction in town.It was built with assistance from the Japanese and the Qatari government. Before 2011 tsunami, elementary school and junior high school buildings were located in different places. But due to a decrease in the number of students after the earthquake, both the schools were integrated in a new building, thus providing relief to residents. The school can accommodate approximately 300 elementary and junior high school students. Apart from being equipped with all facilities, it also has solar panels that can provide the residents with shelter and electricity at the time of disasters.
山の中腹といいますか、海抜ここでも30メートルぐらいございますので、当時のこう津波の最大の高さよりも、まあ高い位置に作られておりますので、まあ1階部分の方は、まあ地域の方々も避難できるように、こう設計されておりますので、まあそういった意味でこう、震災といいますか、災害に対しての、こう一つの拠点というふうな形にはなれるんじゃないかなと思ってます。
One of the buildings which were destroyed during the tsunami is preserved to remind people of the intensity of the disaster and to show how much progress that has been made ever since. The school has become not only an important part of the town, but has also emerged as an icon of successful reconstruction and recovery in northeastern Japan.
Moving on, the Indian festivals are not just limited to colors, lights and fanfare, but also comprise a set of other cultural values of devotion, dedication and sacrifice. Some festivals even highlight the inherent cultural values of respect and affection among the men and women in society. On one side, there is a festival that celebrates symbolic hurling of sticks on men by women. There's other like the recently observed Karwa Chauth, under which the married women observe a rigorous day-long fast for the longevity of their spouses. Have a look.
Wearing traditional colorful attires, married Indian women across the country celebrated the auspicious Karwa Chauth and observed fast for the longevity of their spouse. Also known as Nirjala Vrat, a strict fasting where women do not consume either food or water, Karwa Chauth falls on the fourth day of the Hindu month of Kartik. On this day, women worship the Hindu god Shiva and his spouse Parvati. On this auspicious day, women gather in groups, listen to folk tales and decorate their karwas or clay pots and puja thali with all things symbolizing a happy married life.
ये सुहाग का त्यौहार है करवा चौथ एंड पूरा नॉर्थ इंडिया में तो ये बहुत पॉपुलर त्यौहार है ये पति की लंबी आयु की कामना के लिए होता है
शाम को भगवान की पूजा करके कथा सुनकर फिर हम चांद का वेट करते हैं क्योंकि चंद्रमा इसमें मेन है और अपने पति को देखकर उस व्रत को हम लोग तोड़ते हैं चांद को देखकर
The day begins with women eating sirgi, a food platter usually prepared by their mother-in-law. The sirgi meal contains sweets, coconut water, vermicelli and many more, a healthy food that allows them to prepare for the day-long fasting. In the evening, they perform puja for their husbands before the moon sighting. The women then see the moon through a sieve and catch a glimpse of their husbands through the same sieve. It is believed that when a wife looks at her husband through a sieve, all negative emotions are filtered through it. According to the Hindu mythology, moon is one of the most important celestial bodies. Once all the rituals are done, then women mark the end of the festival by drinking a glass of water and having sweets to break their fast. Not only for women, Karwa Chauth is equally important for the husbands because their wives specially dedicate the entire day praying for their longevity and prosperity. It is also a celebration of love, marriage and the bond shared between a husband and a wife.
Karwa Chauth is predominantly observed in northern Indian states like Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Punjab, Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.
Subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.